we've seen an enormous boom in the use of cloud services because I can now order my processor cycles on demand. And virtualization has been the core technology that's underpinned, you know, this enormous change in the way in which we go about doing business. Actually, as a technology, it's quite old. It first emerged in the 1970s, I would say. Many of the original computer companies produced different computers that had different operating systems for different purposes. They had one for accountancy and they had one for scientific computation. And IBM, when it started pushing the IBM 360, which was a complete breakthrough in computer architecture, they realized they were losing businesses from other sectors because they couldn't run some of the operating systems that they wanted. So they invented the idea of running a virtual machine, a virtual computer on top of the physical computer, and realized rapidly that you could actually run multiple virtual machines at the same time. So it's an old idea. There's been quite an enormous growth recently in the use of virtual machine technology in, you know, cloud computing infrastructures, as well as being available on your desktop in order to run virtualization on earlier versions of the x86 family or everyday PC platforms. You needed some software. Let's start with VMware. This came out of a bunch of very smart people at Stanford who realized how to perform software emulation of virtual machines. In simplest terms, we often have two different levels of privilege to run software on our computers. We run an operating system, and then we run our applications. And the operating system can use instructions and access memory and do things that the applications can't. And that's to avoid the applications either maliciously or accidentally crashing the machine. And of course, the operating system can, but it's presumed that a lot more energy goes into making sure that works. And you don't want every time your application crashes, especially when you're developing it, that it takes out the whole machine. And these are often in all sorts of different computer processors. There's a hardware mechanism that implements this. It's sometimes called the kernel mode or supervisor mode. In the case of the sort of the Intel family of processors, it's called ring 0, and this is ring 3. Now, at this point, you may ask, where are ring 1 and 2? They are present, but they're not commonly used by most everyday operating systems. But just think of it as the two privilege levels. So we have this picture, and say we want to run multiple virtual machines. This operating system is clearly in charge of the ring 0 in terms of the privilege mode. So what we try to do, we'll try to run an operating system in the user context, and then we'll run applications on top of that. So how do we do this? Because this operating system running up here in user mode, it will try to issue instructions and access things that will cause a fault. I mean, well, you know, that's not, the application's not permitted to do that. And of course, the trick is, this tries to do things that are illegal, and what we do is we make sure it comes into a piece of the operating system that's been placed there to provide virtual machine support. And whenever it does something that only an operating system can, it looks at what it was trying to do, and then causes that effect to happen by emulating the instruction. Now, on many processors, they are essentially designed to be easy, to be virtualizable, so they're very simple instruction set where it's very easy to decode what's happening. The x86 instruction set is not one of those processors. It's a rather gnarly processor in terms of its instruction set. It's often quite difficult and sometimes ambiguous as to what it was trying to achieve. And so it was an intellectual marvel when people managed to figure this one out. One other slightly different architecture that's worth looking at is the Zen virtual machine monitor, which is an open source one and very popular. It underpins, for example, a vast majority of open source cloud service provision today, including it runs at the core of Amazon's compute service. Zen took a slightly different approach, which was similar in a sense, but it had a very small hypervisor.
Is it like a supervisor but better?
Correct. So, you know, the terminology is quite old. It comes from operating systems often used to be called supervisors. And then when someone said we have something that's, you know, that can run multiple supervisors, then what shall we call it? So hypervisor was the word that was coined. Again, we are talking 1970s here. This ran in ring 0. It's a very much smaller piece of code. And there's one privileged domain, domain 0, which actually has the operating system and accesses and all the physical devices. So I mean, a very important function of an operating system is to access disk drives and Ethernet interfaces and graphics cards. And now, our guest operating system, as we call it, the thing that's being hosted, it then traps into the operating system, so it traps across into domain zero. So slightly different. It's not in the operating system, it's actually a thin layer, but it achieves the same effect. It emulates what that process was trying to achieve. Now, of course, the software emulation of this is, the performance is not that great. I mean, you're talking about having to execute what previously was one instruction, could take many thousands of instructions. You're also talking about what's called a protection switch, where you switch from one domain of protection to another. That has a cost in terms of just the number of processor cycles. So that's where we were, say, 10, 15 years ago. It didn't take long before Intel realized maybe they should add virtualization support. And the VT technology, as it's referred to, was developed and released into, so nearly all Intel processors now have a virtualization support. And so rather than having to emulate a lot of this in software, rather the software constructs a series of tables that the hardware can access and just make the decision about what's trying to be achieved. So today, what this means is that we have virtual machines, and running in these virtual machines, we can have lots of different operating systems. They can be the same operating system, they can be variants, they could be Windows, they could be Linux, they could be different variants of Linux. Very importantly for the commercial sector was the ability to run legacy operating systems like Windows NT 4. All of the new hardware, all the fancy new graphics cards, everything, Ethernet interfaces, disk drive, all of the new bits of hardware, of course, Windows NT 4 hasn't had any software updates for a long time and it can't use them. So it has to use them in a backwards compatibility mode. So actually by running NT 4, inside a virtual machine, you can get the sort of performance advantages of modern hardware, even though that operating system doesn't support it.
I remember NT4 from, say, 15 years ago. Who's still using NT4? There'll be a lot of people wondering that.
Well, there's still people using OS2, if you go back older than that. In fact, there's probably some people using NT3.51. The reason is, it's sort of a terrible secret of the software industry. We refer to unloved and uncared for code as dusty decks. So the phrase dusty deck, it used to refer to an unloved and uncared for stack of punched cards that have gathered dust. And you then now need to rerun this software. Particularly a problem if you've bought software in that's proprietary, the company's gone bust and no one's looking after it, there's no support and your business depends on it. There's a fair chunk of the financial services sector continuing to run very old legacy codes. In fact, they're still running, some of them are still running code on mainframes because they can't move it onto modern processors. They enabled people to get the performance advantages, but also deal with the fact that hardware fails over time. But this allowed people to migrate onto new hardware, upgrade. But also, now, if this didn't need much performance, and you've got this enormous 64-core processor now tanking away, you can just give one processor to that operating system, and you can use the other processors for other operating systems. In a multi-core processor, where there are multiple processing elements, all of these operating systems are actually running at the same time. One of the sad truths is that we haven't yet become very good at writing applications which can truly use a large number of processors, although they use things called threads. They tend to really be sequential in their behavior, mostly sequential. And so they can only really make use of one or maybe two processors. And of course, in cloud computing, I can sell those small virtual machines to different customers. So now as a customer now, I can rent a machine of whatever size I need. 1 core, 2 cores, 4 cores, 2 gigabytes of memory, 4 gigabytes. And the configuration of that is all done by software. I didn't have to go and buy a particular hardware configuration. So if you look at the cloud service providers today, the way in which I can provision a new server in the cloud in a minute is because they're provisioning me a virtual machine and it's all under software control, and they just create the virtual machine on demand and find a spare processor somewhere and run it and hand me back the details to allow me to access it.
The mathematics, as far as we know, is okay.
So is this a bit like I've got 17 locks on my front door, but he's going in the window?
Yeah, so you go in the window or you pull the wall down. You can find other ways in. You can always find other ways in.